So there's this question. The question is, I have a Python program that needs to write to a file in a directory owned by root. I want to restrict access to this file to strictly this program and root. So one thing you should know is that SE Linux is a complement to the discretionary, the two traditional discretionary access controls, the Linux security model. So that means that it's a separate layer. Basically, you can look at it as you can look at SE Linux as if it were a layer below the traditional Linux security layer. So that means that first Linux checks the traditional Linux permissions, and if those permissions are satisfied, it checks the SE Linux permissions, and if those are satisfied as well, then access is allowed. So that means that you will have to basically deal with the traditional Linux permissions also, and that Linux cannot override those. So with that in mind, let's just assume we have a system. This is an enterprise Linux 6.4, I guess, system, and it's tuned a little bit, so it's not your default system. Linux 6. Probably EL 6.4. Anyways, so it's tuned. The SE Linux policy is tuned to behave strict rather than targeted. So it's a targeted policy, but it's tuned so that it behaves like the old strict policy model, which is no longer available in Enterprise Linux 6. But in Enterprise Linux 6, you can tune the targeted policy to behave like the old strict policy. Anyway, so we basically just assume we have a program that writes to a directory owned by root. So I guess that would be a directory like var lib my app. And of course I need to be root to even create that, so I'll just go to root and try that again. And then list the attributes. And as you can see, or I'll just use dz. As you can see, the directory is owned by root. Yet, everybody is allowed to read the directory and to traverse that directory. So, read directory, that means basically list it, and the X means traverse it, and it's owned by root user and the root group. And the dot means that SE Linux restrictions apply. In this case, this is the SE Linux security context, and basically only when it comes to files, basically only the third field applies, sometimes also the fourth field, but not in this example. So basically we'll just concentrate when it comes to files to only the third field, the type field. So but this is something we're touching on a little bit later, not right now. So anyways, the file is of the dir is owned by root, and anybody can read the dir and traverse the dir, and root can actually write to it, the root user can write to it as well. So let's create a simple shell script. So I won't create a Python script, I'll just create a simple shell script, and I'll just use and then user has been my app. So I insert and I'll create a dash, make sure, git dash, and then basically what I'll do is I'll just echo something in the file there. So echo test, and if the file doesn't exist, you can create it. Var live, and it's a real stupid example, but it should show you. So that's all it does, it's just echoing, and I'll also echo something to the terminal. Actually, I'll. So, if. Equals zero, then simple script, see if it actually works, because my bash skills aren't all that good, and then exit. Something like that. Okay, let's just save and exit that, and then gmod plus x user has been my app, and let's just see if it. So there's already syntax error. Is a directory. Oh right. So let's open it up again. My app and a file. My app. Oops. My app. Text. There's no error checking of any kind. Syntax error else. Error. I don't want to waste too much time just writing a simple script. Works. So basically, now the file is there. It was created by root and is readable by any user. So, if I, for example, exit out, and now I'll try to do this as a unprivileged user, permission is denied, fail. So basically, you need to be root to actually be able to write, because the file is the dir and the file is owned by root. Now, for example, you could change the Linux permissions on the file, and then it might be able to write to the file, but that's not the idea. So we'll go back to the root shell. So now we basically want to restrict access to only the My App application, so that only the application can write to the file and of can access the file and as root. So basically we need to write a simple policy module for that, and make there my app in my home directory, cd my app, then just basically create a policy module my app, and this is source policy module type enforcement file nano. That's my favorite editor, but it's not installed, so I'll have to try. And then module my app 1.0. This should be a proper declaration for a policy module. That there are two ways to write as a Linux policy, and this is the way that is preferred, or it's preferred. It's the way that in a language that as a Linux can understand. There's also another human readable language, and basically in an abstraction language, which makes it much easier to write policy, but like I said, that's an abstraction, and this is basically the default language we write it. So now basically we need to create a type, declare a type for the process, so the MyApp process will be sandboxed using type enforcement, and the identifier of that sandbox for that process is basically this type, so I call it my app underscore t. Another type we need to declare for the actual file, so this is basically the file as Linux does type transition from one type to another, usually on the exact when it executes a file, usually in the most basic scenario. So basically what we'll be saying is when the user executes a file with a given type, then type transition go from the type that was assigned to the user to the type that is assigned to the process. So we give the file a type, we declare a type for the file my app exact underscore exact t. Exact t basically tells us it's an executable file type, just for the sake of giving the name of the type a little bit of a intuitive name. It doesn't, you could call it anything, but just for the sake of being intuitive, we'll just call it that. So now we have two types. Basically, now we need to basically tell SE Linux what kind of types these are, because to SE Linux these are just types, and we already made the decision, oh, this is a type of a process and this is a type of a file, but as a Linux doesn't know that by just these two declarations. So there's a concept called type attributes, which are basically kind of like tags that you assign, and those type attributes are used to group policy that apply to a group of types rather than a single type. So basically by grouping stuff you give stuff a meaning. Now, since we are writing this policy module in a already existing as a Linux environment, there's already a policy configuration in place, and that policy configuration has properties, and so we need to basically integrate this module into the existing policy configuration so that we can basically take advantage of all the existing type attributes and stuff, so that we can write the policy efficiently, and so that it basically blends in well into the existing policy. Although there, by using existing type attributes, you might implement some functionality that is unwanted, but will might get into that later. For now it's just we'll just use whatever is available in the existing policy to write it so that it blends in as well as possible. So we have those two types. We have a policy module declaration. Now we need to make those types usable. We need to classify the types. We need to use type attributes to group the types to tell SE Linux this is a type of this kind and that is a type of that kind, so that basically we can write policy more efficiently. If we wouldn't do that, then we would basically have to write a bunch of duplicate rules and stuff might break because stuff depends on stuff. So anyways, let's just save this and let's just have a look at some existing attributes. So if you run at the info and you'll use the option, then you get a whole bunch of existing attributes. You can basically list it and then let's do it. And just like with types, it's the habit that you give a attribute, if you create an attribute, that you give it an intuitive type, so that by just looking at the attribute you can basically already tell what the meaning of the attribute is. So for example, you have here an exact type, so one could assume that this is an executable file type. A cert type, one could assume that this is a certificate file type. A file type, one could assume that this is a type for a file. So there are a few of those that are interesting, but anyways, just to show you that the list, there are 269 attributes. Look at them as tags, as metadata, and that we can use. So now there's another command you can use, and that's basically called at the info, and then you use the X to basically expand, and then you can use the T to expand the type to see all the type attributes that are assigned to a particular type. So let's for example take a type that I know exists, and it's called RCT, or at least it should exist, and see what attributes are assigned to that type. Now basically, if you look at the type itself, and you noticed our type that we created was the myapp underscore t type, and I already told you that would be the type for the process, and so you could already assume by looking at the name of this type, RCT underscore t, that this could be the type for the RC process. So this type has three attributes assigned. Now I'm not going into the UBAC constraint type attribute because it applies to the UBAC security model, which is not applied on this system and is not applied on any Red Hat system. And so for the sake of simplicity, I'll just skip over this one. You don't need it. So the other two attributes you do need. So basically it says, oh, this RC underscore T type is has assigned the application domain type and the domain application domain type attribute and the domain attribute. Now something that you should know, when we refer to a domain, we basically refer to a process. And to make it more sensible, a domain is a process type. Is a type of a process. So when I use the word domain, I refer to a process or a process type, and when I say a process type, then I refer to a domain. Now, so this basically says this type, the RCT type, is a process type. It's a type assigned to a process, or it's the type of a process. And the application underscore domain type basically says it's a domain type, just like the domain attribute, but it also says it's an application domain type, which basically means it's a application. It could be, for example, a daemon instead of a daemon domain type. Well, that's unlikely, but it could be another sort of domain type, in a daemon domain type. It could be a signed domain type, maybe, if it exists. So basically we're going to use these two attributes and we're going to assign that to our myApp_T_type. So back to the, now these type attributes are declared in other modules in the existing policy configuration, so we in order for us to use these attributes we need to import them, so we require them, require, and then we require the domain attribute as well as the application domain type attribute. Alright, so now we basically imported it, and now I can basically assign these type attributes to the myApp_T type. So type attribute is the type statement used for this, and then we say domain, and application domain type. And not sure if the syntax is right, but we'll see about that. So we've done that. Now next we'll go to the executable file type that we declared above quickly, as quick as possible. So we'll save this and we'll do the same. We use the seinfo command and we'll do the same for the rc_executable file type. I just know these types. It says if you want to see all the types, you can basically use the T option and it'll give you all the types. And if you look at the names of the types, then you can basically see executable file type, for example. So you'll see the _exec, so you know it's an executable file type. Or the _conf, you know that it's a configuration file. Var log, you know it's a log file. Var run, you know it's a pit file. And usually, if you use it consistently, the type names, then by just looking at the type, you can already tell what kind of type we're dealing with. And but you also need to make sure that if you use this workaround by looking at existing type, that you choose a type for an for a process that has the same properties as your process. So back to the XT, so we'll choose RCT exactly and just see what kind of attributes that type has assigned. So here's a few types attributes that that we're all going to use. So basically it's a file, it's the type attribute file type is assigned to the rc_exec_t type, basically telling SELinux this is, or basically grouping this type into the file type group, tagging it with the file type tag. It's an exec type, so it's an executable file type, basically putting this type into the group of executable file types. It's an entry type, so this is basically this has to do with the type transition concept that I touched on earlier. Basically it's an entry file, it's a file an entry file to a new domain basically. And it's a non-security file type, which is basically in this model, in this policy model, is basically assigned to all files that are not security related. And it's an application executable type. So we had the application domain type, and now we have the application executable file type. So this is basically a executable file for an application. And you could have other executable file types, for example the core command executable file type for basically core commands for core utils, anyway, so these are the attributes. So basically by just classifying our types properly, we're basically grouping our types in the proper existing groups, and that will also apply the proper rules that are already in place to our types. So by just classifying our types properly, we already add a bunch of policy that applies to the group of types, to the classification of types, rather than just this type or these types that we declared. So require, and then basically I'll paste it in. A bunch of attribute file type, attribute exact type, attribute entry type, attribute non-security file type, and the attribute application executable file type. So close that and then assign them. Type attribute my app _ exact t is a and this is not a capital T, is a file type, exact type, entry type, non-security file type, and an application executable file type. So now we basically created these types and we made them usable. Now, next thing we need to also, and I forgot that, but I'll just do that now, create a type for our var like my app t location. So type my app var like t, and then basically make that also usable. So save and exit, and just have a look at some other type for files in var like. So we can just basically grab var like, just look for all types and then just grab var like, grab var like. And then you get all these types, which are basically all types of private types of stuff in var like. So for example, let's take the Kismet var like type and see what type attributes it has assigned, because Kismet is also an application that needs to be run as root. So as the info xt and then Kismet is met for live t, x is that for expand, and basically just has two attributes. Basically it's saying, oh, that's a file, it's grouping the kismet _ var _ live _ t in the file type group, and it's grouping it in the non-security file type group, so it's not a security related file. So let's just copy this over, go back to our source policy type enforcement file, insert, and just require the type attribute, and then just paste that in. File type and non-security file type. So, and now just basically assign it. Type attribute my app var like t like t, getting a little bit dark in here, file type non-security file type, Okay, so now basically that is also classified. So ASI Linux now basically knows in what groups these types belong. Basically, it knows what types they are. And to expand a little.